Evening. Wow, that's loud. You can bring me down just a little bit, Derek, please. Thank you. Okay, well, back to Genesis. Seems like it's been forever. We're in chapter 14 to finish that up tonight. And, you know, it's funny, the first few weeks after being back from Israel, it seems like everywhere that you look in the text, you're remembering something from the trip. And what we left off with is Abraham on his way back in from his routing of the kings, that he went as far as up into Damascus. But it mentions Dan and the area where he was at the time when he first heard that Lot had been taken. If you were here for that study, you'll know that it's kind of in the area where we call Beersheba anyway. That's kind of where they did a lot of their things. So he and his descendants were in that area quite a bit. So where we left off and where we'll pick up tonight, chapter 14, we're going to pick up at verse 18. And we're introduced to one of the most fascinating characters you will find anywhere in the scripture. And it's not because of what we see about him in Genesis. It's because of what we see about him, what Paul, or whoever the writer of Hebrews was, what he has to say about him. And that's where it becomes more than just a little fascinating. So we're going to do that. We're going to take a look at this Melchizedek guy. And we will do it in light of what is in the book of Hebrews and why is it so important. But then we also get to the allotment of the land in chapter 15 and some very interesting things there too. So Genesis chapter 14, let's turn there and let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for gathering us here this evening, and we're so grateful to get back into Genesis tonight, and we pray that you would assist us by your Holy Spirit in understanding your word and why these things are important and why we should know them. We thank you for your faithfulness to us and that you do everything for a reason, for a cause. And so as we study your word and learning about this Melchizedek, it for the generations didn't make a great deal of sense until you explained it even further in the New Testament, and then all things became understandable to our ears. We thank you that you do that with your word, that we could have faith, that we could know. We give you praise and honor this evening. We pray that you glorify yourself through the teaching of your word, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so again, chapter 14, there was the wars that were going on with these eastern kings that were coming from what we would call Assyria. And from that area, or Mesopotamia, had come down. They were doing all the things that they were doing. And then there was a coalition of the kings down here in the south. Abraham had heard that Lot had been taken because of the routing of these southern kings. And so Abraham went after Lot and some of his trained men. And so where we are in the story, or in this narrative, is as he comes back in, he's met by this guy, Melchizedek. We only hear about him in one place in the Old Testament as far as who he was. Now, there is a very brief description of him in Psalm 110, and we will look there in a moment. But we get this little glimpse of who this man is. Now, what you'll find, there are so many oddities about him, and it has created all kinds of interesting conjecture about who he actually is, and I'll give you some of the details. We don't need to go that far, but we make some observations about him, and by the time that we get to the book of Hebrews, there are some details that are given to us by the writer of Hebrews that aren't even in Genesis. And so their history, of course, passed some things down, apparently. Well, in chapter 14, at verse 18, we read, "Then Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought out bread and wine, and he was the priest of God Most High. And he blessed him and said, 'Blessed be Abraham of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand.' And he gave him a tithe of all." Now, I got my wrong glasses tonight, so I'm going to have to keep either looking down my nose or taking them off. But the description of this guy is fascinating. Now, the first thing, God is making a covenant with Abraham, correct? We would call them the Jews or the Hebrews, right? And yet, here is this guy Melchizedek, who then, by definition, would have to be Gentile. Kind of an interesting character. And so we don't know anything about him. He just comes out of nowhere. But his titles are fascinating. There is no priesthood because that's way down the line. That's tribe of Levi. There aren't even tribes yet because there aren't even kids. So you don't get to tribes until you get to Abraham and then Isaac and then Jacob and then Jacob's kids before you start to get to the tribes. So there's no way that there is a priesthood yet in the way that we think of an Old Testament priesthood. And yet here is this guy who is a priest. And he is not just a priest, but he is also a king. So he's a king priest. Very unusual. There are so many characteristic things that are different. Now, if we fast forward and we think of Jesus as being a priest, he is indeed that. He is referred to as great high priest. And so we see him as that, but we also know that he will come back as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So the idea of a king priest is highly unusual, Old Testament or New Testament, but in Jesus you have no problems with such things. However, you do have the limitation, how could Jesus possibly be a priest? He's from the tribe of Judah. He's not from the tribe of Levi. That's where the priests come from. Now that all gets answered in the text, which is great, because it's not like God goes, oh man, I forgot about that. Now what am I going to do? Well, you'll see by the time that we're done tonight, the whole reason why I believe, and I'll put it this way, I believe the reason that we get this information in chapter 14 is because of Jesus. And because that whole thing, that accusation could be made against God, wait a minute, Jesus can't be a priest because he's not from Levi. That would be a real problem, because God is not going to be contrary to his name and to his word or anything else. And so we are getting the opening salvo, if you will, of the reasons why Jesus has no problem being able to be a priest. Well, so we look a little bit more at this man, Melchizedek. He is the king of Salem. Now, Salem, when you look at Psalm 76, David uses that same term, Salem, peace. But it's meant for us to understand we are talking about Jerusalem here. But Jerusalem is not even established in the terms that we would understand by this time. Jerusalem isn't even on the map as far as a location, and yet here this Melchizedek is from that place that we would call what would become known to us as Jerusalem. So he's a king. He's the king of Salem, what would become Jerusalem. And he brought out an interesting thing. Bread and wine. Same thing that Jesus had in the upper room. So you start to get into, there are a lot of potentially mystical applications to this. We don't need to go farther than where the text takes us. But of course it is intriguing to notice it. Now look at, here's what it says, that he is also a priest of God Most High. Now if we think of priests in that part of the world, when Abram's just coming into it, most of what we would think is paganism. And yet, he's not a priest of the pagan gods. He's the priest of God El Elyon, so God Most High. Now, if we're wondering who that is, you'll notice in his blessing to Abraham, he says in verse 19, and blessed be, this Melchizedek, blessed Abraham, and he said, blessed be Abraham of God Most High. So the same God. So the one that Melchizedek would identify with is also the one who is blessing Abraham by the name and in the name of the same God. So how did he know? Impossible to answer. We don't know anything about this guy. He just kind of comes out of nowhere. And there again will be a reason for that. But here is this very fascinating person with all of these attributes and titles. And so, it will keep in mind where it says that he blessed him and he said, be reminded of that there was a blessing that was here. He says, blessed is Abram of God Most High. God Most High, who is the possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hands. So you'll notice he is saying this to Abram in a greeting. Meets him with bread and wine. He's a king. Not a king of just anywhere, but he's a king of Salem who also happens to be a priest, and not just any priest, but a priest who would not be of the covenant people, because the covenant people are right there in their infancy in the person of Abram, and yet he's got all the right credential. So, notice what also happens, and keep this in mind for when we get to the book of Hebrews. And so it says at the end of verse 20, and he, that means Abram, gave him a tithe of all. Tithe of what? The spoils All the things that happened when they took on those kings, when they went and retrieved Lot, and they brought back a bunch of stuff. And that bunch of stuff will even be an issue. But you'll notice that he gives a tithe. And it's a way of support. And there's a reason why that is significant. And it's the book of Hebrews that picks this up. Now, I am of the opinion the only reason why this is necessary. Let me just throw this out as a question. If we didn't know anything about what we just read, does it change the story of Abram becoming this man who gets a promise of generations and seed and a nation that will come from him and all the rest of that? No, all of that stuff would still be intact. Wouldn't be a problem. If we didn't know about this, though, there would be potentially a problem down the road of how does God get around the idea that Jesus would be a high priest since he wasn't from the tribe of Levi. That would be an issue, would it not? Turn with me to Psalm 110 before we move on. Psalm 110. This is the only other place that you will find in the Old Testament a name mentioned, Melchizedek. It's the only other place where he's brought up. Now, interesting, he's not brought up in the sense that there's a comment about Melchizedek. The topic, or I should say the object of the discussion, is the person who is being pronounced as a priest here. So let's read Psalm 110. And we see at the beginning, verse 1, it says, "The Lord said to my Lord." Interesting titling here. Because he is David, if you will, witnessing a discussion between two who are superior to him, and they are in the form of deity. So, let's put away all the pretense. This is the Father speaking to the Son. This is the Father speaking to Jesus the Son. And here's how we know that. "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." We all know when that's going to be. When he comes back as the conquering King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So there's the king part of it. Now, how do we deal with the priesthood? "So the Lord shall send," in verse 2, "the rod of your strength out of Zion, rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will be volunteers in the day of your power and in the beauty of your of holiness, rather, from the womb of the morning. You have the dew on of your youth. The Lord has sworn and will not relent. You," the Father speaking to the Son, "you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek." Interesting. And nothing more is said. The only thing that is mentioned here, and the important part of this, again, here is David. By this time, the tribes have come. There is the tribe of Levi. There is the idea of the formal priesthood. There is a functioning temple that is coming, and there is a formality of worship that is already in place as David writes that. And yet here, he records for us a discussion between the Father and the Son, where God the Father is saying to the Son that I have called you to this thing, among many things that Jesus was, however, to be one who would function as a priest. But not according to the Levi tribe, not according to that Levitical priesthood, but to a priesthood that predates it by hundreds of years, Melchizedek. Yeah, that peculiar fellow in Genesis 14 that we know next to nothing about, because he pops up out of nowhere as Abram is coming back from the north, and he's coming back down to his land, travels through the area of Jerusalem, and this guy meets him with bread and wine, blesses him. And you'll see what the book of Hebrews says about who blesses whom. Now, let us ask this question. When you speak to a Jewish person and you ask them of the important people in their history, they can give you a number of names. But then there is a whole upper level of a very select few people who are of greatest importance. And at the top of that list is Abram. He's the father. I mean, everything began with him. So when you look at the nation of Israel, when you look at the people of Israel, the Jewish people or the Hebrews, it all began with the promise, which we are going to see reemphasized in chapter 15. But he's the one that it started with. Now, Moses has a very important part because through him, he's the lawgiver, and that's a hugely important thing and all the rest. But there isn't one greater in their history that you would point to and say greater than Abram. He's at the top of that list. There's no question. And yet, He's being blessed by someone else, and then he will end up paying tribute or tithe to that person, this Melchizedek guy. And then you'd figure that the rest of the Bible would be littered with information about this Melchizedek, but it's silent. Nothing. You get that little bit in Psalm 110 that's not even speaking about Melchizedek. It's speaking about somebody who will be a priest according to his order. And here's the other part that's interesting. What do we know about the order of Melchizedek and that priesthood? Nothing. Bible's totally silent on that, and that's just fine. So if all we had is chapter 14 of Genesis, this little bit, and Psalm 110, we would go, what is that all about? Great question. Melchizedek is mentioned 9 different times in the New Testament, and it is all in the book of Hebrews. The only place you see him mentioned at all. So let's go there. We'll take a look at it. Let's turn to chapter 6 of the book of Hebrews. The first mention of Melchizedek is actually in chapter 5. But for what we want to look at tonight, we're going to go to chapter 6. And then it transitions into chapter 7. And that's where the argument, if you will, is. So what you have in the book of Hebrews is God putting a nice fine point on something. Chapter 14, we might say, what in the world and who is this guy Melchizedek? This is the most baffling thing ever. Why do we have all that detail about a guy who has credentials as far as the eye can see, and yet we only have a scant little bit of information about him? And then all of a sudden, David sees a conversation and says that God is saying to his son that you're a priest to me according to the order of Melchizedek. How do you make sense of all of that? All of that is put in place, I believe, absolutely only because of what is being argued here in chapter 7. In particular, of the book of Hebrews, because by the time that you're done with it, nobody else could fulfill what is said in Psalm 110, because now the book of Hebrews settles it. It's Jesus. There's no one else that could ever be applied, because the Bible is now telling us what all of that stuff means between Genesis and Psalm 110. The writer of Hebrews settles it. There's no more discussion. I love it how the Bible does that. Let me just tell you something that was really cool. In Israel, we had got to Qumran. And at Qumran, that was where they found the Dead Sea Scrolls. And our tour guide was explaining about the scrolls that were there, and he was saying, look, the Bible that you have in your hands is trustworthy, and we know that because of what they found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, anybody would have been able to make an argument that, well, how do you know? It's been translated so many times, you don't know that it's true and all that stuff. Well, in the Dead Sea Scrolls, they found an entire, you know, basically every book in the Bible with the exception of Esther. And so he said, now you look through them for their accuracy compared to what you have in your hands, and it's like verbatim. There are no problems. And he said, the only place that you have any discrepancy is found in the book of Isaiah, where it says that a virgin will conceive. And that virgin that is being spoken of, we all know, is Mary. Now, he says in the scrolls that are here, it is not virgin, but it is Alma in the Hebrew, which means an unmarried woman. Doesn't mean that she's not a virgin, but she's unmarried. And so you could see in some of the people, it's like, oh, wow, that, you know, that kind of just, that makes it a potentially a problem, because then people start to wonder, well, is it really accurate? Is she really a virgin? And boy, if you start to attack the virgin birth, you've just destroyed Jesus' deity. He's just a product of human reproduction. So it was really cool to be able to say, all right, it was after he said all that, that it was my turn to you know, do the study part of it and why we were there at Qumran. And so I said, well, isn't this great? Because the Bible always settles stuff. So this unmarried woman that is being spoken of in Isaiah is obviously Mary. And so let's go to the source. What does Mary have to say? She's told, you're going to have a child. What was Mary's reply? How can this be? I've not known a man. So she settles her virginity. She's unmarried, absolutely. She can't be possibly pregnant. She says it herself. I haven't been involved with anyone. How can this be? So the Bible validates the Bible. How cool is that? So we know that this Melchizedek is here in chapter 14. Why? Well, because Psalm 110 is going to roll around. And somebody is going to be a priest according to the order of Melchizedek, and he's going to be deity. So then there's still the question, well, how does that all work out? Book of Hebrews. Nice, neat, tidy little bow, and it's done. And you can't come up with another explanation. So, chapter 6, at verse 19, it's the summation of the argument of chapter 6. So, This hope we have, and it is an anchor to our soul. That anchor to our soul and that hopefulness is that Jesus does what he does, and he has redeemed us back. We have this hope. And it says, it is both sure and it is steadfast, in which enters the presence behind the veil, where the forerunner has entered for us, even Jesus, having become a high priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. Oh, so now Jesus gets introduced to us as being able to be the high priest. Now, the high priest would be that man who one time a year would go into the Holy of Holies and make an offering. Now, that is going to dominate the next few chapters of the book of Hebrews. But how can Jesus do all of the priestly things if he is of Judah and not of Levi? Easy solution. Because God recognizes him as one who is able to perform as a priest, not according to Levi, but of a much older priesthood, in this case, Melchizedek. Now, if Genesis didn't tell us who this Melchizedek guy is, this argument doesn't make any sense because we don't know anything about him. But if you were to read this yourself and say, so what do we know about this Melchizedek? Well, he's a king, he's a priest from the area of what we would now call Jerusalem, before it was known as Jerusalem. And he was so great that he was able to bless Abraham as the greater that blesses the lesser. But who's greater than Abraham? And Abraham paid to him a tribute. It's a big deal. Well, chapter 7 says this. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abram returning from the slaughter of the kings, and he blessed him, to whom also Abram gave a tenth part of all, first being translated King of Righteousness, and then also King of Salem, meaning the King of Peace. Now, here in verse 3, we get details about him that we don't get in Genesis. Because it says, without father, without mother, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like the Son of God, remains a priest continually. It means that there wasn't an end to his priesthood. Now, as the writer of Hebrews is saying this, really, there is the temporal aspect of a priesthood in the Old Testament sense, because those guys couldn't continue to be a priest. They had a shelf life. They would either die or they would get old enough that they would have to move aside and someone else would have to come in. So there was a deficiency there. And here in this case, this Melchizedek, since we don't know where he came from, we don't know when he was born, we didn't know when he died, if he died, because he may have been very much supernatural. We don't know anything. We know nothing about his genealogy. We know nothing of those things. So because of that, it is an open-ended priesthood. It didn't have an ending because we don't even know when its beginning was. He just comes out of nowhere in chapter 14 and then vanishes. You have that one little passage in Psalm 110, and now the writer of Hebrews speaks about this Melchizedek guy and say, because of that, now because it is open-ended, and God recognized it, needless to say, Psalm 110, God recognizes this priesthood, and now Jesus is able to be the high priest who goes into the Holy of Holies with an offering of himself, as we see in a couple more chapters. And so he's able to officiate, if you will, on behalf of the people as a priest, as a high priest in this case. And so if he was to have to show his credential, who are you to operate as a priest? He's according to Melchizedek's order. Now look at what else it says, verse 4. Now consider how great this man was, to whom even the patriarch Abraham gave a tenth of the spoils. And indeed, those who are of the sons of Levi, who receive the priesthood, have a commandment to receive tithes from the people according to the law, that is, from the brethren, though they have come from the loins of Abraham. But he whose genealogy is not derived from them receives tithes from Abraham and blesses him who had the promise. Now, beyond all contradiction, the lesser is blessed by the better, or by the greater. So the writer of Hebrews says, let me make sure you guys understand this. The idea that a blessing was received and that a tithe was given by Abraham to Melchizedek puts him in a just a very unique category. But there is so little we know about him. So the writer of Hebrews is trying to say to us, don't try to figure it out. It's not supposed to make sense as we might think of it. It is to let us know that Jesus is able to operate before God as a high priest according to an order that is so exclusive and so different from that of Abraham through Levi and the priesthood that was so filled with failure, Here is a faultless, no failure priesthood that Jesus is now able to officiate. Does that make sense? I mean, this is just, there's cool and then there's this. Because you're saying that God has made sure that there is no problems in Jesus being able to do the things that he does. He is absolutely able to do the things that he does because God is the one who has given him a title or a way to do the things that are necessary. Because he was going to make that offering for sin. He was going to offer himself. But who is he to be the high priest? Unless, of course, he is part of a priesthood that predates anything that we know of priests. Pretty cool, huh? This is like Bible geeky 101 stuff, and it's just awesome. Now, verse 8, here mortal men receive tithes, but there he receives them of whom it is witnessed that he lives. Even Levi, who receives tithes, paid tithes through Abraham, so to speak. And so the point is, the priesthood that came through Levi and that was subordinate to a priesthood that they don't really much know anything about. Because God was doing these things long before Abraham even had his first child. Okay? So Isaac needed to have Jacob. Jacob needed to have the sons. They needed to occupy the land. They were going to be given the law. All that stuff still was so far down the road. And yet God is already at this point putting together a priesthood that Jesus could take on the mantle of that priesthood and officiate as he needs to. God never misses a beat. Pretty interesting, huh? Back to Genesis. So, in Genesis 14, it continues on, and that is it. Now, again, we have looked at only two or three verses, and look at all of what is implied in that. I mean, it's enormous. And notice how matter-of-factly we go back to verse 21. Now, the king of Sodom said to Abram, "Give me the persons and take the goods for yourself." But Abram said, He said to the king of Sodom, "I have raised my hand to the Lord God Most High, the possessor of heaven and earth, that I will take nothing from a thread to a sandal strap, and that I will take nothing that is yours, lest you would say that I have made Abram rich." So Abram had already made the agreement before God raised his hand and said, as an oath, "I won't take anything of the spoils of this war," aside from what he gave to Melchizedek. And then for the people that came with them, that they could get back their, if you will, their pay. But I'm not going to take any of it because I don't want the king of Sodom to be able to say, "Look, I've made Abraham who he is." He wanted God to take the credit for that and him alone. Verse 24, "Except only that the young men have eaten and the portion of the men who went with me and these guys. Let them take their portion." So the rest of it, you can have it. You take credit for it. You do all that stuff. I don't want any of it because I don't want you to rob God of his glory. Now, from there, instantly transitions now back to the promise, which has begun. It had begun at chapter 12. And God had told him in the first few verses, "I'm going to bless those who bless you. I'm going to curse those who curse you. I'm going to make a great nation out of you." Now he begins to go into more detail on that. So chapter 15, verse 1 tells us, "Now after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, 'Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, and I am your exceedingly great reward.'" What a great line. What a great way of looking at it. It is God saying, "I am your protector, and I will be your inheritance, your great reward." Now, we need to recognize that that promise that was made to Abram at this point, that really does extend to those people that would be part of those nations blessed because of him. And yeah, as far as the Messiah is concerned, we look at God and we can say the same thing of him. That he is to us, yes, Gentiles who are born again. God has his covenant with the nation of Israel, and it's still in force to this day. God never rescinded what he said in chapter 12. But the idea that God, on behalf of his people, is that protector, that shield, and that he is our great reward, what a wonderful way of looking at him. And so he says this to Abram. And then, interesting, Abram reads into that by saying, well, he said, "Lord God, what will you give me, seeing that I go childless And the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. It's funny because God only said to him, I'm two things. I am your protector, I'm your shield, and I'm your great reward. Well, okay, great. Now he's still focusing on the, all right, well, I'm supposed to be having a great nation and my generations will be more than you can number, but I don't have any kids yet. So patience. Remember the promise, from the time of the promise till the actual realization of it was about 25 years. You ever waited for something from the Lord for 25 years? So you ever get impatient with God? When are you going to get around to making good on your promise? You ever waited around 25 years? There's precedent here, folks. Don't get out ahead of him. Wait. So, he does ask the question, verse 3, then Abram said, look, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Now, here's one of the cool things, and it is instructive to us. He has defined it that it is not going to be someone that is one of your servants or anything else. It will be someone who will come from your body. And it does leave him the option open, and we know that this is the thing that he and Sarah come up with. Instead of saying it will come from you and Sarah, that leaves the door open for them to ultimately be disobedient. They take matters into their own hands. So, in this case, of course, you know, we know this about Abram. He trusted God and it was accounted to him as righteousness. Okay, great. Doesn't mean he was perfect. It means that he believed that God would make good. Didn't mean that he was going to make some mistakes along the way. We know the rest of that. We're going to be studying it in these weeks to come. Well, it says in verse 5, so then he brought him outside and he said, look now toward heaven and count the stars, and if you are able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And verse 6, he believed in the Lord, and it is accounted to him for being righteous, for righteousness. Righteousness very simply just means this. Righteousness means being in the place of acceptability. God is pleased. He is accepting of your situation. So, remember, how can this be? Because we think Old Testament, we think the law. But let's remember that God was having Abram walk with him, not according to the law. That came through Moses. That's generations from now. He asks him, do you trust me and do you believe me? And if so, walk by faith. So here, he believed the promises that God made. So let's remember, before there was the law, there was faith. And God would ask a man, as he did with Abram, hey, I'm going to ask you to do this. Do you trust me? I'm going to take you to a land. Do you trust me? I'm going to make a nation out of you. Yeah, you're old and so is your wife. Do you trust me? It was always that. And so it was to be able to look at that and say, it doesn't have to make sense to me. I have to believe that the one making the promise is worthy of my trust, that he'll make good on the promise. Doesn't have to make sense. I don't know how he's going to do it, but he promised he's going to make good on his promise. Right? If you are able to have that view of God, no matter how imperfect you may be in your day-to-day life, that is a righteous act. We believe God and we walk accordingly. That is a way of being in a right place with God. And when failure comes in, we take those things to the cross and seek Him for forgiveness. But do we still believe in the promises? That's the issue. That's where faith comes in. So, as we read this, this is what we're told. Now, here's what happens next. Verse 7. Then he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans, and I gave you this land to inherit this. I mean, your exceedingly great reward, remember? Your shield, your exceedingly great reward. Now, here, I'm going to give you this land. And he said, Lord God, how shall I know that I will inherit it? How will I know? What's the covenant that's made? Verse 9, so he said, bring me a 3-year-old heifer, a 3-year-old female goat, a 3-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. So these would end up being kosher. Before there was such a thing. So he's saying, I'm going to ask you to make this offering. Now, remember, this is an offering that is way different than anything else that we see. Now, there's speculation as to why this is. It may have been customary that these kind of things, there are writings that give the impression that this might have been the way that they would make covenants in that time. Again, don't become dogmatic on the whole thing. But it is God who sets this up. Take these animals, and what you're going to do is you'll offer them, but you're going to cut them in half, and you'll lay them on their sides, and you'll leave a path that's in between, and there's a reason why that is. And it goes on and explains it. So he says, so he brought all of these to him in verse 10, cut them in two down the middle, placed each piece opposite the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. And when the vultures came down on the carcass, Abram drove them away. Now, when you read this and what even comes on from there after, it is a very unusual thing that's going on here. And you're not going to find this kind of thing repeated in other chapters, in other times, in other places. It's very unique to this. And there's a reason why God's making a covenant. And so a lot of times people will look at this and say, is there a lot of symbolism in this? Is there a symbolism to the birds that would come on and try to eat these carcasses and the fact that Abram drove them away? There's a lot of potential implication to this. What we do know is that Abram didn't want anything to spoil the sacrifice. Now, if it's a symbolism kind of a thing, that would make he being the patriarch and, you know, overseeing and keeping, you know, away from danger and all that, the covenant represented by these animals and all the rest. Yeah, you can do that. You can take all of that stuff and find plenty of symbolism in it, but the Bible doesn't explain all the symbolism, so it's best not to read more into it than what you see. Here's what we do know. This is a covenant that God is making with Abraham here, Abram, making this covenant with him, and it's done, and it is, yes, highly symbolic. Now, if this is following the traditions of the time, both of the people, both of the participants of this covenant would walk through the midst of them. Both of them being able to say, as that tradition would go, if either one of us breaks this covenant, so may it be to us what is happening to these animals, being cut, let it not be separated kind of a thing. That's the imagery that you see here. But the way that it is ratified hereafter, Abram's not involved in the process at all. And it's fascinating. Now, there's a little break in the narrative here. So it says in verse 11, when the vultures came down on the carcasses, that Abram drove them away. Now, when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and behold, horror and great darkness fell upon him because of what he saw. Now, it's not that he was being tormented, and it's not that kind of thing. It's what he saw. The imagery was very troubling to him. Now, let's remember, reset here. He hasn't even had his first son. In fact, the next person who would call him father, who would be a son to him, was not even the one of design. It wasn't through Sarah. That was going to come after even that. But now God is showing to him his generations and what awaits them. And this is what is so troubling to him. Look at verse 13. So then he said to Abram, know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years. Now here's an amazing thing. We know the whole story of Exodus, right? We know the whole story of how they got there. In fact, the rest of Genesis is going to lead us to Exodus and the person of Moses. We are going to know about the generations from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob to the sons to going to Egypt and getting away from the famine that took place there, and Joseph and all of his exploits, and how God showed him favor in Egypt, and that the next Pharaoh comes in and enslaves the people. But I would guess that there are many in this room probably that didn't know that Abram was told that it was going to happen. Before he even had his first child, God is telling him that there's going to be a time when your descendants are going to go away into slavery in Egypt for that time. Now, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but I remember years ago reading this, and I go, oh my gosh, God showed that to Abram? Before he even had children, he told them that there was going to be a time of their captivity and of their bondage and all the rest of it. That's pretty amazing. So God's telling him all of these things. Now notice it goes on. And also, the nation who they serve, I will judge. Afterward, they will come out with great possessions. Now as for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace, and you shall be buried at a good old age. Now that's an interesting thing again. Because here he's telling them and forecasting the generations to him. I'm going to give you generations, the people that will be innumerable, whether he uses one of two images, sands of the sea or stars in the heaven, you will not be able to count the number of your descendants. But he's telling them that there's already going to be a time when they will go into servitude, but that he will ultimately bring them back. Now that, again, to me is incredibly fascinating, because he's telling him all of these things And that really covers the rest of the book of Genesis into the book of Exodus. But he also says that he's going to judge Egypt for the way that they do the things that they do. Now, little caveat, little side thing. We are getting to that point of the year. There are two times a year when it comes around. And I haven't noticed them, and I haven't been watching TV. We've been out of the country for a while with Israel and all the rest. But we are coming up to the time of resurrection. We're at the time of Passover. All that stuff is happening around the world, and people are starting to pay attention. What does that mean? That means history or the Discovery Channel or one of those, they're going to come up with some just, or a whole, they're all going to do it, come up with some goofy thing of trying to explain away stories out of the Bible. They're going to tell us that Jesus, you know, is not who we thought he was according to some, you know, lost gospel, that he's, you're going to be treated all kinds of just silly, crazy stuff. One of them, interestingly, that I've seen, and it always seems to happen around this time, why they decide to do the Ten Commandments around Easter, I've never really been able to fully figure out, but hey, what do we care, right? But they will focus on the Exodus. And they will explain how it was that the people, the children of Israel, as Moses leads them out, how it was that they were able to go across the Red Sea without drowning. And they explain it's because, you know, that at various times a year that the water levels go low and there's these high places of land and whatnot that are just beneath the surface and all the rest. And they say, and there's this prevailing wind that if it blows hard enough, it pushes down on the water, and it would actually just help to part the water enough to where they could walk over a land bridge. Seriously, I kid you not. I remember watching a guy trying to give a demonstration in his own little tank he was, you know, one of the ivory tower professors, and he's explaining how it is. He actually took a leaf blower, and he had this nice acrylic tank. And with the leaf blower, he blew the water down, and it separated out. And you could see how if there was land just under the water, when the wind hit it, it would move it aside enough to where they could walk through. Shazam! There it is. That's how they got through. And it completely dismisses the miracle that God parted the water. Of course, you run into another problem, because how did then God manage to drown a whole Egyptian army in that? So however you slice it, you're going to have to deal with a miracle here. God either brought his people across on dry land, or he drowned the entire Egyptian army in a couple of feet of water. It's impressive no matter how you do it. So, again, let the scripture speak for itself. You don't have to try to find a way to explain it away. My goodness, if you could explain God away by just natural circumstances, you no longer even have God. You have somebody that you've made up in your own mind. Well, in this case, he tells him, this is going to happen to the generations down. Now, this is not going to be you. You're going to die at a good old age. But in the fourth generation, they shall return here, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. Oh my goodness, how fascinating is that? This means that God has something going on with the Amorites. We always think of them as the ones that they're having to fight when they come into the land, as though we don't know anything about them. But remember, when God says about the iniquity, that kind of thing, that means that he's watching the things taking place and giving them place. Remember, that was what was going to happen at Nineveh. He was going to wipe those guys out. Jonah went there, worst evangelist ever, who was really upset that God saved him. I knew you were going to show mercy to those people. But remember, he gave them place. Now, it's an interesting thing, and I've had this conversation with people just recently. They look at how God, oh, look, he's a God of war. Look at when they came into the land that he just, you know, Joshua was the oppressor and he came in and he just started killing people and all the rest. God's so violent. Notice it would be Joshua, because he's the one that led them into the land. He was the one who was the instrument of God's wrath on the Amorites, who by this time, their judgment had come full. It happened to Israel a number of times. God would use the Gentile countries to come in and do the things to Israel because their time had come. Because of their waywardness, they were being judged. Notice right here, he says, they're going to be displaced out of the land until I'm done with the Amorites, and then you guys will come back into the land. And they will be his instrument of judgment against the Amorites. That is, again, I'm staggered at this. Because we think of this stuff as being Book of Joshua kind of stuff. Here God is telling it to Abram before there is a nation, that this is what's going to happen. There's going to be a time of servitude. And after that servitude time is over, your people are going to come back into the land and they will subdue it, because that will be the time that the time of the Amorites has come to full. Wow. So again, verse 16, it's in the fourth generation. Now that doesn't mean that, okay, so generation from which generation? Think 100 years. He's already said it's going to be 400 years. Fourth generation. At the end of that time, generations being thought of in that 100 years comes back into the land. Okay, great. So then verse 17 says, now, it came to pass when the sun went down and it was dark, that behold, there appeared a smoking oven and a burning torch that passed between those pieces. So now back to the sacrifice that was there. What we've just had is kind of an interruption in the sacrifice that was taking place, because the sleep fell upon him, God showed him something. Now back to the sacrifice. Notice that this is very much a supernatural thing. It is not Abram that has provided this. It is God who sent, as best we could see, something that was having the effect of cooking, if you will, or consuming that meat. And so it was seen as fire or an oven, but it passed between. Notice it is not Abram that does this. And if this imagery is more like the times of the people that were there, it would have to be both parties who would have to enter in or engage in this covenant. In this case, since it is God who goes between them, it is God who is making the covenant, and it's unilateral. It is God making the covenant with Abram, because he's the one who has promised it to Abram. Now, Abram will be the beneficiary, as will the generations, but it is God who passes through and ratifies, if you will, the covenant. So he's the one who passes through in verse 17. Now in verse 18, it says, now on the same day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying to your descendants. Can I have you guys queue up the, I have an image I want to queue up. And as that thing is loading, he says, I'm going to make a covenant with Abram, and this, he says, to your descendants I have given this land, and it is from the river of Egypt, that is the great river, we would call it the Nile, and then to the river Euphrates. What I did is I took the liberty of drawing this out for you guys. Now, whenever we hear it talked about of, we want to go back to the borders, we want Israel to give back the land that they took in the 67 war and go back to the original borders. I always chuckle and say, which borders originally do you are you referring to? Because do you see the black line there on both sides? Israel's that little red outline in the middle. Now that would be if you took in what we call Gaza and the West Bank. That's the red part. Here's what God gave to Abram. This is what I'm giving you. So the Euphrates begins, the headwaters of the Euphrates come up at the top of the Mediterranean. That's modern day Turkey. Look at how much of Iraq and Syria and Egypt. That's what God promised to him. Can you imagine if we started talking about, yeah, let's go back to the original borders. World War III, folks. But that's what was promised to them. Now, I'll be a little political here. We were just, again, as you well know, we were just in Israel. And most people don't know this about that place, but in Israel proper, outside of the West Bank, what we call the West Bank, used to belong to Jordan. As far as God's concerned, it always belonged to them and a whole lot more. But if we look at just what is there, inside Israel proper, there are over 1 million non-Jewish Arabs that live in Israel proper. And they have much of the same rights as citizens. There are some exclusions, of course. But when you get into places where it is completely held Palestinian territory, no Jews are allowed. In fact, when you go into them, there are signs posted. No Jews, by law, are allowed to be here. So what you see in our news is usually about 180 degrees out of phase. They make it seem like Israel's the oppressor. I'm seeing a few of the people in this room were on our trip. And when we started driving through Bethlehem, which is a wholly owned city run by the Palestinian Authority. No Jews. In fact, our bus driver and our tour guide have to have special permission to be able to enter in, and they've got to call the authorities when they go in and when they come out. Now, here's what's so interesting about that. When you go in, you ought to see the houses. And so we're driving in, and we're in the bus. I grabbed the microphone. I said, please, everybody grab your cameras. Take pictures of what you see on both sides. We're talking palatial stuff. those people in those lands don't create much of anything. So it's not commercial interests that give them what they have. It is foreign aid. And you can know who is connected and who is not, because there are people who live in absolute poverty in Bethlehem. And then you have pillars, marble, and I mean just palatial things on either side as you're driving in, but right across the street you've got shacks. And the difference is, are you connected or are you not? So I was telling the people on the bus, take as many pictures as you can and tell as many people as you can what really goes on here, because you'll never see it on CNN, ever. You'll never see proper reporting of this. So when it goes to this idea of land and who owns it and all the rest, there are two things important for us to understand. The fact that there is a contested and disputed land called the West Bank and another one called Gaza. Gaza belonged to Egypt and the West Bank belonged to Jordan. They would still be in the same position they were if Israel was not attacked. Israel took them in war, and I'm glad that they took the West Bank in particular, because Jerusalem is there, East Jerusalem in particular. And yeah, it is a strategic matter. But it is also one of, you can tell who runs what part just by taking a look around. It's one of the things I love to point out when we're in Israel, because we go in and out of those territories. And to be able to point to people and say, just notice that. Why does it look that way? Why is it in that condition? Look who runs the place. There is a care and a concern. We watch people that will just, they'll have trash in their hands. They will just throw it out the window. They have no respect for the land, nor do they have any care for it. But you can tell the other ones who do. They recognize that it's a covenant kind of a thing. And there's a love and a care for the land. It is a fascinating thing to see. You have to experience it with your own eyes. But if you ever want to hear somebody talk about, well, the land, show them this. Now you know the text. It's right here in chapter 15. Okay? It is from the Euphrates to the Nile. So all you have to do is trace it. And we're just being, you know, we're being generous by just making a line across to the bottom of both. The Nile dead ends just below Luxor, you see there, into a lake, or then it continues beyond by that. So we'll be charitable and say that that would be the end of the Nile. That's the first place that it empties into a larger body of water. But if you just snap a line across, look at how much of that land is what was offered by God to Abram. Wouldn't it be fun to have that discussion? Yeah, you want to talk about land? Well, we know where God gave it, and here's how much it was. There you have it. It's right there. It's found in verse 18. So Genesis 15, 18. And then it says, this is all the people that would be the inhabitants of the land. The Kenites, the Kenizzites, the Kadamites, Hittites, Perizzites, basically all the Ites. Those are the people that are in the land. Now, in case you ever have one of those situations where people would say, they try to make the equivalence of modern-day Islam and Old Testament conquest that was taking place. We don't even call it conquest. We find out right here from what we just read that God was using them as the agent, if you will, to pronounce judgment and conquer those ones that God was waiting until there was just no more time left. They had gone and exhausted. Their time had come. You will notice the Kenites are an interesting couple or an interesting bunch, because when Joshua comes into the land and he's going out to deal with the Amorites, then you will notice that he meets this group of people called the Kenites and says, guys, don't get in our way. We're not here for you. So for those people that would like to say, see, God was just warring and he was having them do the same thing, you're no different than Islam. Really? You will find where Joshua says to a group of people that are not of the nation of Israel, look, just stay out of our way. We're not here for you guys. We're here for those guys. And it was not an open-ended warfare either. It was specific to a group of people for a specific amount of time, and it was not an open-ended kind of a thing. In Islam, it is. It is. It is open-ended warfare against anyone who would qualify as infidel. And in case somebody says, well, there are peaceful chapters and peaceful verses in the Quran, and there are warlike ones, they will always, if they're trying to be the apologist and talking about that it's a religion of peace, they will pull out the peaceful passages. But if you know about Islam, you know that inside of Islam there is the doctrine of what they call abrogation. And abrogation is that you can supersede one verse with another. And it is actually in the Quran says that, because God can change his mind, or God can change what he has said, because he's the one who keeps the law and he keeps his word anyway. So if he wants to go ahead and contradict himself, it's his right to do so. So abrogation is always able, you can contradict one with the other, and the peaceful side never wins. So wouldn't it be interesting if you were able to say, well, I can find one verse in the Bible that seems to contradict the other one, and I'll pick the one that I like. That's what preachers do all too often, frankly. You don't find contradiction in the scriptures, not in the Bible. You will find it in other faith traditions, and I could, if you ever wanted to, I'd be able to show you contradiction after contradiction, sometimes within the own chapters. One of the surahs, a very, very long one, number 2, surah number 2, has contradictions inside of its own chapter. And so, yeah, I have my own copy of it and all the rest of that. You wouldn't know it because I keep it turned around. You can't read it. You can't tell what it is. So if you ever look behind my desk, why do you have that book turned around? I don't want to even read the spine of it. All right, so enough of that. Chapter 15, as we close, it explains the boundaries of the land and the people who inhabited it. And he basically says, this is the land that I give to you and to your descendants. And here it is. So now, chapter 16, as we transition to that next week, we have one more week. And then the following week is triumphal entry. So we have 2 more weeks to study this. And then we'll have 1 week off for resurrection. And then we will pick up at chapter 16 next week, though. That is where the... this is taking matters into your own hands. Hey, look, God said we're going to have kids, and so Sarah says, basically, I'm old, so are you, but my servant is not. So, whoops. Getting out ahead of God and not getting more detail. You know what would have stopped so much, and really the fallout of what we're about to read, the fallout of it continues to this day. To this day because of Ishmael. And we will explain that a little bit further. Wouldn't it have been great for Abram to have said, all right, you said he's going to be from me. Is he also going to be from Sarah? Because if he'd have asked that question, there would be no Hagar, there would be no Ishmael, and there wouldn't be the problems that we have to this day. So hang on to your hats. Genesis is going to be a blast. Remember, we are at the point now where we've moved away from... At chapter 12, basically, is where we've picked up the beginnings of God's dealing with the nation of Israel, and it continues all the way through the sons of Jacob, leading to the Exodus at the end of the book of Genesis. So it'll be a blast. Let's stand and we'll have a closing song. Let's pray. Father, we thank you once again for gathering us in this place and for giving us your word, getting a chance to study a little bit about the history of things, recognizing what your promises have been, and they are so much greater than sometimes we even realize. We thank you that you have left no stone unturned to our understanding, and even the idea of settling, how is it that Jesus can be our high priest and not violate your law? We thank you for your faithfulness to us, and we thank you that you have seen to all of the details that we can trust. We thank you, we give you praise, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise. Thousand years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, and worship His holy name. Sing like never before. I'll worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name. Yes, I'll worship your holy name. Amen, and God bless you. Have a great evening.